morning. Welcome. Glad to see you. Glad that you are here today. Let me share with you a note that I received. We received in the mail this week to all of you. It says, "Dear friends at Open Door Church, what a pleasure it was to serve our gracious God at Open Door Church. We appreciate the prayers offered on our behalf. Also, you showed Southern hospitality." Now, coming from a Southerner, that's a big, big statement. "By all the fruit and food brought to the pastor's house and to the work site. All was very good," underlined, "very. Thank you so much. We look forward to our next trip to Lee, renewing friendships and working with you to build God's kingdom, remembering you with prayers and praise in Christ. The missions team from Faith Baptist Church, Quitman, Arkansas." So I want to share that with you. Your kindness did not go unnoticed. And I say that and then to tell you that this week we received a call from a friend over in Schenectady, New York, and they are bringing, if you read the email that I sent out, he is putting together a team of people to come and work this Thursday at the property. Now, their intention is to take that western wall and do what was done to the eastern wall of the gymnasium, and so be praying for them. We worked yesterday seeking to get that ready for them so that they can accomplish as much as possible. We'll be continuing to do that. You might notice in the bulletin that there's a work opportunity on Tuesday night. We'll have someone there. And then on Wednesday, trying to get ready for Thursday. So be aware of that. Pray for them. And also this team on Thursday, one thing that we'll be responsible for is to provide a meal for them sometime in the middle of the day. So Martha's going to coordinate that. If you want to help with that, if you can help with that in some way, this will be a team of 8 to 15 hungry men. So, I've been told that it's better not to feed them too much at lunch, or else they want to take a nap instead of working. So you ladies be the guide of that, be the judge of that, and that'll be good. But we look forward to being able to see that work completed there, and so this is another step in that. So, also on Tuesday, Franklin Graham is coming to Boston for the Decision America tour. If any of you are interested in going to that, a couple of us are planning to go, and we'll have to leave early in order to get there because that begins at 12 o'clock noon there in Boston. So, if you want to be a part of that, please let me know, and we'll try to accommodate you in that. But let us all just pray that God be glorified through this congregation, that we be the people that He's called to represent Him here in a way that draws people to Himself. So let's bow together for prayer as we worship today, as we give Him praise. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we come to You, Lord, how great and mighty You are. Father, for us to be able to have the privilege to come and sing praises to You, what a blessing that is. The week would be so long, just one week feeding into another, if we didn't have this time that we could come together and just join our hearts together so that we can praise You. And so, God, I pray that You will bless us as we sing Your praises and open our hearts, open our minds. Lord, draw us to You that, Lord, we may fully understand, that we may better understand just who You are and the blessing that You have given us. So, Lord, be glorified in this as we offer our praises, for we pray in the precious and holy name of Your Son. Amen.
One of the great joys that I find with reading through the Bible, in studying the Bible, is that God has chosen through His Word to disclose Himself to us, and that He is, through His Word, telling us about Himself and His nature and His heart and His mind and His plan, and not fully, of course, because no words could contain the full mind and heart of God. But as I was thinking about that this morning, I thought about the words that the prophet Jeremiah wrote. And the book of Jeremiah, of course, is about the transition of the house of Israel from a place in the Promised Land to captivity for the sin that they had done throughout, and the forgetting and ignoring of God's will and way and his disclosed instruction. But in the midst of that, he is so compassionate. And so I wanted to read, this is a familiar verse, I'm sure, from Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. "For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope." So even at the cusp of their deliverance to the king of Babylon, his heart was for them. He wanted to remind them that his heart was toward them and not against them, and that he would bring deliverance. And in concert with that, I was just thinking about this, in concert with this, the Lord says in his word that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So the Father's heart for us is revealed in that he is for us and not against us, that he wants us to spend eternity with him, that he loves us and cares for us, and that he is the epitome of the good Father. Let's stand together and sing.
Thank you.
All right. So what do I have with me today?
Eggs.
What?
Eggs.
Eggs. Eggs. You say that. You don't have a particular smile on your face when you say that. But eggs are good. And I brought these eggs now. I want you to know something. You're going to have to get close so you can see. There is a difference in these eggs. Don't touch them. Because when I touch them, sometimes I have to be careful lest I break them. Come look. Tell me if you can see a difference between any of those eggs. Which ones are different?
These ones are plain white. These have speckles.
Oh, some are whiter than others? Is that what you're saying? Some are not as speckled?
Some have freckles.
Hmm? Like freckles. Some of them have freckles.
Freckles.
All right. White. What's that? What do you think is the difference?
Five of them are just plain white, and the rest are brownish color.
Hmm. When I look, I guess your eyes are better than mine. When I look at them, they all look white to me. So I guess your eyes are better than me. Maybe it's the shadows that you're seeing. But there, I promise you, there are two that are different. There's two that's different. It's not five of them. There's only two of them that are different. Can you see the two that are different?
I see the two that are different.
These two.
No, it's not those two.
This one.
No, it's not those two.
These two.
No, it's not those two. See, you can't see a difference because I know which ones are different. You know which ones are different? This one and this one are different. You know why they're different? Can you see a difference in them?
One's smaller.
No, it's not the difference. Can you see a difference in this one, in these, than the other 10? Can you see a difference? Huh?
This is pink spot instead of red.
Well, those have...
different too.
Yeah, well, all right. These two are different. You know why? It's not because of what's on... It's not because of what's on the outside. You know why they're different?
Inside.
It's because they're on the inside. They're what?
Hard-boiled.
They're hard-boiled. How did you know that? Did you know that? Well, that's exactly what it is. These two have been boiled. And do you know what happens when an egg gets boiled? The inside gets completely different. It gets hard and it's different. And then when you crack one that's hard boiled, it doesn't run everywhere, does it? It doesn't just bleh, go everywhere. But instead, it's solid and it's good. And I love to have eggs when they're hard boiled. And that's good. But you see, the difference is what's on the inside and not what's on the outside. Do you know when Jesus comes into your life, there's a difference that takes place? You know where that difference takes place? It takes place on the inside mainly. You may be a lot the same on the outside, but on the inside there is a big difference. Now, how does that difference take place? Does it just happen automatically? Did these eggs just automatically get boiled?
No.
Did they all of a sudden just come out as boiled eggs? No.
No, someone had to boil them.
Someone had to do it. Something had to happen to them. They had to go through an experience that changed them on the inside. Do you know that's the way it is with our relationship with God? We don't just all of a sudden get different, but instead something special has to happen to us, and it happens to us on the inside as we put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And that difference is that He comes into our life and He changes us. The changes that happen on the outside are going to be because of what happens on the inside. You are getting dangerous here. Okay. I don't want a mess. So let me put my eggs away because all of those, I have a special purpose for every one of those eggs. Okay?
To make food.
Yeah. Okay. So let's pray and just thank God that He's a God that He can change us on the inside. And we know that there has to be that experience sometimes where we put our faith completely in the Lord Jesus Christ. It doesn't just happen, but it's something that has to take place in order for us to be a child of God. So let's pray together and thank God for His blessing today. We want to thank You this morning, dear God, that You have made a way for us, that You've made a way for us to be changed from the inside out. I thank You that, Lord, You have Your hand on each of our lives, but we know that every one of us, in order to be changed, we have to have a similar experience, an experience in which we recognize that we have sinned and recognize, dear God, that You've sent Jesus to die on the cross to pay for our sins, and we put our faith completely in Jesus. So I pray for these children and pray that every one of them, Lord, might have that experience so that, dear God, they might be changed on the inside so that, Lord, You become everything to them and Lord and Master of their lives. We ask this for each of these children. Pray that you'll bless them this morning as they go to class, that they will learn more and more about you. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Amen. You know that there's a special verse in Scripture that has always been one that I seek to keep before me. It's one that I desire to live up to. It's found in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33, where it says this: "But seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." Now, He's not talking there about all the things that we would desire. He's not talking about every dream that we have, that He's going to give us fame and He's going to give us fortune if we put Him first. He's talking about all of your necessities, all of your need. If what you're looking for is peace, then you'll find it in Him. If what you're looking for is purpose, you're going to find it in Him. Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these other things will be added to you. This concept was so real to the Christians that we find in the book of Acts as we read about their lives. We find that both their homes and their occupations were platforms for the ministry that they were to do for Christ. These things were not the focus of their lives. These were things necessary in life, but not their focus. Now imagine how much different life would be if this were true. And then picture yourself standing before the Lord Jesus and explain to Him why it was not true, if it is not true. Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. What would such a life as that look like? Well, we are privileged to look into the lives of those individuals. And in the 18th chapter of the book of Acts, we find a special couple. And we, as you study their life, as you see them, as they pop up every now and then in Scripture in the New Testament, you realize that's exactly how they lived their lives. A very special couple, a couple by the name of Aquila and Priscilla. So what was it that allowed them to be effective ministers for Christ? What was it that made them different from so many other people? What might we be able to see in them? Well, first of all, we know what makes the biggest difference in a person's life, and that is what we call conversion. A person coming to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. We know this is the greatest thing and the most important thing. As you read these verses, you find that Priscilla and Aquila were Jews who were forced out of Rome. They had to leave their home because of persecution. They were individuals who were Jewish, and until they met the Apostle Paul, they did not know the Lord Jesus Christ, but Paul led them to Christ. Listen to what it says of them in Acts chapter 18. It says, "After these things, he left Athens." Talking about Paul, he left Athens and went to Corinth. "And he found a Jew named Aquila, a native of Pontus, having recently come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because Claudius had commanded all the Jews to leave Rome. He came to them." This couple had no choice in the matter. They had no choice but to leave their home. And if you can imagine being driven out from the place where you were, having to leave because of your heritage, this is what they had experienced. They left Italy and they moved to Corinth. They didn't know when they had to leave there that it wasn't that God had abandoned them, but instead that God had provided for them, that God had a place for them to go, that God had a purpose for their lives. He was going to do something special with them, because you see, had they remained in Italy, they would not have met Paul. Had they not met Paul, they might never have heard the gospel. You know, I love the way that verse 2 ends. It's almost, as you see it in most translations, it's almost as though they should have put the verse a couple of words earlier. But this second verse ends in this way. It says, "He came to them." Isn't that great? The Apostle Paul came to them. He was sent to them. He went to that city, and he went there because God had enabled him to go, had instructed him to go. Now, we are not told of the moment of their conversion, but we have no doubt that it took place. Why do I say that? Well, you can see it in their lives. You see it in how God blessed them and used them. So even though we're not told exactly of the moment when they trusted the Lord Jesus Christ, there is no doubt that they did. Now, I am certain of this. It was not long after Paul met them that he opened the Scriptures to them, and he explained to them that Jesus is the promised Messiah, the one sent by the Father to become their Savior. Picture, if you would, the change in their faces as the Holy Spirit of God opens their eyes to the truth as the Scripture is revealed to them. Can you see them in that moment? Do you remember such a special time in your own life? Can you see the tears of joy that flow down their cheeks as they commit their lives to Him? No doubt when they were forced out of Italy, tears had flown, but they were tears of a different kind, thinking maybe that God had done something to them. Now they realize God has done something for them. Now they realize what's going on. You see, their sorrow at having been forced from their home was replaced by the joy of knowing that they have a new home, a heavenly home, because of Jesus. Their uncertainties about the future were replaced by the assurance that God would guide them, that He would provide for them, that He would bless them. Their lives were changed when their focus was turned from themselves to the Lord Jesus. That is conversion. That's the difference. A person, when we come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, up until that point in our life, it's about us. It's about what we want. It's about our dreams, about our aspirations. At the moment that we come to Jesus, how do we come to Him? We come to Him as Lord, and He becomes our master, and He becomes the focus of our lives. That is conversion. Now, if there's never been a point of time in your life when you accepted Jesus as Lord and Master of your own life, then the Scripture would say that you are not saved, that you are not a child of God. And if you are not saved, if you've not been delivered from your sin, then you are still in your sins. Now, God is working in every person's life. He is working and has worked in your life to bring you to that point where you might be able to put your faith, your personal trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 10:13 says, "For whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved." That's what we do. We call upon Him as Lord. We receive Him as Lord. And we know that we could try to be like everyone else. We could try to change the outside. We could begin to do things that we would consider to be serving Christ. We could do that without a solid assurance that we had experienced conversion. But there would be no change. Because you see, when we talk about conversion, we're not talking about changing from one religion to another religion. People think that what we're doing when we tell them about Jesus is we're trying to convert them to our religion, to our particular brand of Christianity. And they might think, well, you're just trying to convert me. Well, we are seeking to convert a person from worldly to heavenly. We are seeking to take them from a place of being a sinner to what the Scripture refers to as a saint. Now, that is what we talk about with conversion. It's not about one religion or about another religion. It is about taking them from a time of separation from God to a place of spiritual reality, of a personal relationship with God through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. When we look at Aquila and Priscilla, the one thing we know about them is they were converted. There was a conversion that had taken place in their lives. Now, I can't look at any individual and see within them. I could have broken those eggs open and shown the children that certainly those two were different than all the others, that what was inside was different because it had been changed. Now, I can't look at the outside. You know, people look very much the same to me. But whether or not you've put your faith and trust in Christ is something that you know on the inside. You know whether that heart has been changed. The second thing that we see about them that made them what they were is what we would refer to as commitment. It says in verse 3, and because he was of the same trade, he stayed with them, and they were working. For by trade they were tent makers. Now, reading this passage of Scripture, you may feel that Aquila and Priscilla were nothing but incidental to what the Apostle Paul was doing. That he went to them because they were tent makers. He was a tent maker. And so it was a convenient thing for him to go and stay with them in order that he might be able to fulfill that trade, in order that he might be able to do something so that he'd have food on the table when he retired in the evening. You might think that their relationship was circumstantial, that it was a matter of convenience. But that was not the case. They were very really missionaries for Christ. They had put their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and when they did, they became missionaries for the Lord Jesus Christ. Because you see, what we find with Aquila and Priscilla, we find them to begin with in Corinth, where they've had to flee from Italy. But then we find them later in Rome helping to start a church. And then we find them again in Ephesus, as they are mentioned as being a blessing to Timothy. You see what we see in them is we see a commitment to Christ. Wherever they were, wherever life took them, they were committed to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, a person who works at a secular job so that he or she can support themselves financially while serving Christ, there is a term for that. We still call that being a tent maker. That is someone that their job is all about providing for their needs in order that they might be able to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. There are people who certainly would tell you that what they are is a missionary, that they've gone to another place and in that place they work for a living in order that they might fulfill their greater purpose, and that being the sharing of the Lord Jesus Christ with others. We still refer to that as a tent maker. But would you agree with me that this is a very rare thing to find in individuals living in our society today, to where people look at their lives that way and they treat their jobs in that way? Is that not a rare occasion? A person who's willing to do that, that's what all of us need to be willing to do. Now, it may be that God will never ask you to leave the place where that you are to move to another place. And since you're here, I pray that most of you, that won't happen to you. But if God were to send you out, I would pray that we would be a church that we would teach people this so that when they go out from here, they would recognize that they have not only left their mission field here, but they've gone into a new mission field, and somehow that we might be able to help them along the way so that when they go, they are stronger in the Lord. Because there will be always, there's always that change within churches, but God can be, He's the one who should be behind that in every change that we make. So are you willing to serve Him anywhere and everywhere? Are you willing to look at whatever else other circumstances there are in your life and say, God is behind these circumstances? And I will glorify Him, and I will serve Him in this place. Look at verse 4, beginning in verse 4. It says, and he was reasoning in the synagogue every Sabbath and trying to persuade Jews and Greeks. You say, well, I feel a little uncomfortable trying to persuade people about what I believe. Paul didn't feel any way other than that that's the way it ought to be. He was trying to persuade people. Though they be Jews, though they be Greeks, though they come out of a religious tradition or a very secular tradition, it didn't matter. He was working to try to persuade them. He was reasoning every time he had the opportunity with them about the Scriptures. And then verse 5 says, but when Silas and Timothy came down from Macedonia, Paul began devoting himself completely to the Word, solemnly testifying to the Jews that Jesus was the Christ. That word solemn, that's translated solemnly testifying, that lets us know this was very serious work. He didn't count it as just something he did. He counted it as the most important thing that he did as he shared with people that Jesus is the Christ. But notice what took place here. He was able to devote himself completely because these other brothers came, and because Aquila and Priscilla were in his life, he was able to not be making tents, but to give his whole attention to the gospel. Now, I believe wholeheartedly that we should pool our resources and fully support missionaries so that they can concentrate all of their energy on reaching the nations with the gospel. What a blessing it was for Martha and myself to be able to go to Brazil and not have to worry about how our needs were going to be met, knowing that there were churches here who had already provided for those needs, knowing that they had met our needs there. What would we have done without that support? What a blessing that was, and what a blessing it was for the Apostle Paul to now begin to give himself fully to the work to which God had called him. But I also knew this. We will never reach our world simply by sending out professional missionaries. We don't have enough money to support that many people as they go. We need to recognize, as Aquila and Priscilla recognize, that wherever God put them, that they were there to do the work of the Lord. As Paul came into a town, he knew that he had a work to do, and we need to be the same. Now, I don't know why we find Aquila and Priscilla moving from, I know why they moved to Italy, it tells us that, from Italy to Corinth, but why they then moved back to Rome and why they moved to Ephesus, we don't know exactly what was going on in their lives and what was going, but we know God was behind all of it. Maybe it was because of persecution, because they loved the Lord Jesus Christ and Satan was not happy with them at all. But they were missionaries for Christ. You know that word missionary means one who is sent. You have heard it said that we're all missionaries, and indeed that is ideally true. It is both biblical, and it is important that every one of us as believers search out the will of God as far as exactly what He would have us to be doing. Are you there? Do you know? Do you understand? Do you realize that you can impact people that nobody else can impact? And that you have a responsibility to share with them the Lord Jesus Christ. We've got to be so committed to the task that we dedicate our God-given abilities and our resources to accomplish the purpose for which He has called us. Now, there's something anemic about Christianity today that we feel too weak to do that. Our faith is too weak. We say, well, that's for someone else and not for us. But let me ask you, what would a church look like that had such a vision as this for its members? Each member having that understanding and that vision for himself or herself. Each one committed, saying, I am here, I am in service for the Lord. Whatever my life brings, whatever circumstances there are, my purpose is to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. That is a New Testament church. That is what we need. And that brings us to the third point, and that relates to what we'll call companions. One of the greatest provisions that God has given us is one another when we are both committed to Christ. Priscilla and Aquila were Paul's companions. Silas and Timothy were Paul's companions. Now, what about this word companion? Do you know where that word comes from? Well, it is the combination of two words in Latin. One of them is com, C-O-M, and that means together. And the other is panis, which means bread. And so these two words, bread together. I'm talking about food, that type of bread. Having bread together. We are companions. We're companions when we break bread together. Now, there's something special about that. That means that we are able to encourage one another. You know, you sit down at the table with someone, there's a particular type of fellowship that goes on in that type setting. You sit down as equals one with another. For us to be companions, that means that we see ourselves at the same place. We see ourselves on the same level. To eat with someone implies a level of comfort with them, a sense of security with them, a type of equality with them. Companions. When Martha and I lived in Brazil, we did the expected. We employed a local lady to work in our home one day a week. Now, had we not done so, we, as Americans, we would have been seen as being very selfish, because they knew that there were people there that needed the work and that certainly being Americans, we could use the help. And so we did the expected, and we hired someone to come and help. One day a week she came and helped with house cleaning. One day a week she fixed our lunch for us. And that was expected of us, but then we did the unexpected. The first day that she was with us, she set two plates on the table. She'd fixed lunch, she set two plates on the table. And then the surprise that was on her face when Martha promptly went to the kitchen, got another plate and set it down at the table and told Hosey, "You need to eat with us. You need to eat with us." She was shocked. She was shocked. She, you see, as the domestic helper, if you will, she thought it was her place to wait in the kitchen to take care of our needs. If we needed something, she would bring it to us. And then after we were finished, whatever was left, then she would be able to partake in it at that point. But to sit down at the table with us implied an equality that she was not familiar with. After all, we were paying her. That made us superior to her. And we said, "No. Hosey, basically we're your companions. We break bread with you. We're not any greater than you are. We are here." And so from that point on, when we had lunch, she sat down at the table with us, and sometimes we wondered whether she ate anything all week long until she sat down at the table with us, because she loved to eat. But in her coming together with us, it showed her that we accepted her. Now again, that word means... the word companion means one with whom you eat bread. Do you know what? We need companions in the ministry. We don't need people who are at a higher level. Sometimes people put missionaries at a higher level. Maybe there's other people that you put on a higher level and you say, "Well, that is different for them. That's a separate calling. That is something different." We need to see ourselves as companions together, working equally together. We are all doing what we are called to do by the Lord Jesus Christ. That is not a one superior to another. That is an equality, and that is what is intended. And that is the reason that every place that Paul went, he assembled people together. He brought them together, and they called that church. There were people who were slaves in those early churches. There were people there that were slave owners in those early churches. But when they came together as the people of God, they were all on equal footing. Companions! And we all need companions in the ministry, and that is called church. May we together fulfill the work that God has called us to do. Let's be companions. That means we're going to eat together. That means we're going to fellowship together. That means we're going to work together. That means that not one is greater than the other, but all of us have our place. All of us have our responsibility, because the only one who is superior in this church is the Lord Jesus Christ, the head of the church, the one that who receives all of our attention. There's a fourth word, and that is the word conviction. Paul came to Corinth because he was convinced that those people needed to hear the gospel and that God wanted to use him to share Jesus with them. Now, this was a strategic point. There in Corinth, that was a strategic point for sharing the gospel, because you may know that Corinth was the great commercial city of Greece. It was located at a very narrow point in the country to where the ships would dock on one side of Corinth, and then it was a narrow strip of land, and they would have the goods then transported over to the other side of the city where they'd be loaded onto another ship. So a ship would come in, be unloaded, the goods would be transported the short distance over to the other sea, and then they'd be loaded on another ship. And so the world passed through Corinth. What an important place that it was. And Paul knew there needed to be believers there, and so he went to Corinth in order that there might be a church that would grow up there, people who would come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ there. You know, sometimes I come down that hill from where I live down into the town, and I come to that stop sign, that famous stop sign there in town, to where the people that are not from here don't know they're supposed to stop when they're supposed to stop, and it's all kind of confusion. But I sit there sometimes, many times I try to avoid that intersection because it seems like the whole world comes through Lee. I mean, you can sit there and car after car after car, and you wonder, where in the world are all these people going? But do you know one reason that God wants to start a great church here? Not just a church, but a church that has a vision for the area. And we're still in the early days of this. But do you know why? It is because Lee is a strategic place. Anybody that goes anywhere in this area has to come to exit 2 and pass through Lee to get to all these venues and all these places. Oh, I believe that God has a purpose for us. Don't get discouraged. Look to the future and say, we're going to do what Jesus wants us to do, and we're going to let Him do it in a way that glorifies Himself. Okay? That's what it's all about. People come here. And if they come here to shop, if they come here because they have to get to the interstate, however they come here from all these other communities, Lee is a strategic place, and we want to be in the heart of that, doing what God intended for us to do. Now, there was another thing about Corinth that made it to where that Paul knew that he needed a church there, and that was because that Corinth was a very wicked place. If someone called you a Corinthian, he was accusing you of immorality. You may not have ever been in Corinth, but if you were immoral, they might refer to you as a Corinthian. But Paul was convinced that what the Corinthians needed was Jesus. Now, I know we have a lot of people around here that are involved in a lot of things, and their focus of life is not upon the Lord Jesus Christ. Whatever it is, I don't know their lives. I can't tell you whether they're wicked or not, but I can tell you they don't know Christ. So important that we be His missionaries here in this place, that we see every person. Sometimes I drive through town and I see those people and I think, God, are we ever going to reach that individual? I see that one that looks so lonely. I see that one that looks so self-satisfied. I see that one that just is so busy going nowhere. I think, God, are we ever going to reach that person? As was his custom, the Apostle Paul went first to the Jews. But notice, if you will, as you study this book, that Paul did not leave Corinth when most of the people of the town rejected his message. Most of the Jews there rejected his message, and others rejected his message. Instead, he stayed, and many of the people there trusted Jesus. Even notable Jewish leaders trusted Jesus because he stayed. Look at verse 6, beginning of verse 6. It says, "But when they resisted..." Now, he was trying to persuade them, but when they resisted and blasphemed. Now, what is blasphemy? That's speaking against God. "He shook out his garments and said to them, 'Your blood be on your own heads. I am clean from now, and I'll go to the Gentiles.' Then he left there and went to the house of a man named Titius Justus, a worshiper of God, whose house was next to the synagogue. Crispus, the leader of the synagogue, believed in the Lord with all his household, and many of the Corinthians, when they heard, were believing and being baptized." Now, at first you look at that, and whenever they resist him, he says, look, I'm not going to focus my attention on the Jews any longer. They've heard, their blood is on their head, it is not on me. I've told them the gospel, I've shared with them the gospel. But then as he says, I'm going to open it up to the Gentiles, he began preaching to everybody. And yet we find that not only was this one who lived next to the synagogue converted, but also the leader of the synagogue believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, and he and his whole family were saved and baptized. Now, what a big thing that was. What a huge thing that was. Can you imagine being the leader of the synagogue and the people, all the people there, knowing that you put your faith and trust in Jesus? And you've unashamedly been baptized for the glory of the Lord Jesus? What a great thing, what a powerful thing that was. And so when Paul says that he told the Jews, you know, your blood's on your own head, know that it wasn't that they were not still in his heart. In fact, in the book of Romans, he tells them that he would, if it were possible, he would suffer their punishment in order that they might be saved. He wanted his people to know Jesus. Where is there a place to minister that people need Jesus more than they do here? I pray that God will burn into our hearts that conviction that God has much people in this area, and He wants us each to be involved in reaching them. And wherever God leads you, wherever He takes you, know that He's taking you there because people there need Jesus. And He's going to put you in contact with them. Listen to what it says beginning in verse 9. It says, "And the Lord said to Paul in the night by a vision, 'Do not be afraid any longer.'" That shocked me when I read that. The Apostle Paul is told by God not to be afraid any longer. I never thought about him being afraid. Don't be afraid any longer, but go on speaking and do not be silent. You say, "Well, sometimes I just can't share because, you know, my throat seizes up and there's that little bit of fear there and I dare not take the next step." Well, the Apostle Paul knew that as well. He experienced that as well. But God said, "Don't be afraid any longer." Now, if you'd been beaten for sharing and you'd been jailed for sharing and all of that, you might be a little bit afraid yourself. In fact, we don't need those experiences for our tongues to be silent within our heads. Listen to what he says. "Don't be afraid any longer. Go on speaking. Do not be silent." Why? He says, "For I am with you." You don't need to be afraid. I'm with you. "And no man will attack you in order to harm you, for I have many people in this city." Corinth, that place synonymous with wickedness, he says, "I have many people in this city." You see, God knows the future, and he knows everyone who's going to come to faith in him. Do you know what I believe? I believe God has many people in Berkshire County that are his. He sees them in the future. He sees the ones that are going to be reached through our testimony, through the testimony of others who are sharing the gospel. He sees them and knows them already. Now, they must come to a place of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not going to happen automatically any more than an egg is just going to get boiled all by itself sitting in your refrigerator. It's not going to happen. They've got to have someone share the gospel with them. He wasn't telling Paul, "You can just be easy because people are. I have many people here and it's all right, so none of it is on you." No, he needed to keep doing what he was doing, but there were many who were going to respond. And I have to believe if he brought the likes of you and me and us together in this place, he has many people whose lives we can touch. So when you are discouraged, be encouraged by that. I get weary. I'm getting tired. I get discouraged. Last Sunday, I don't know if you could tell it, but when I got here at church, I was just down. Praise God for worship. I'm so glad we worship before I preach. Because by the time I preached, I was all right. Because I'd focused my attention on the Lord again. Because you see, I can look at myself and look around me, look at my circumstances, and I want validation from so many places, and I don't get it, and I get discouraged. But then God is my encouragement, and let Him always be that. Let Him be your strength. Let Him be your help. Don't worry. Don't be afraid. Just keep going and keep praising Him and glorifying Him. And I want to tell you, it's all going to be okay. It is going to be all right. We've taken on a lot more for a church of our size than any church I've ever heard of in the history of the church, at least in America. Maybe I can find some in some other places. But do you know what? Our vision is large, even if it is not completely in focus at this time. Expect the enemy to discourage you. You say, "I just feel like I'm by myself." Expect the enemy to discourage you. But don't be afraid. Don't be discouraged. Keep your focus on the Lord Jesus Christ. I expect that I have to get up in the morning and I have to get alone with God and I have to let Him be my strength and be my encouragement, give me energy for the new day. To be reminded that God has called us together and that His will is going to be accomplished. And all I need to do is be faithful and do my part. Because He's called me together, I have many companions in this church. We're walking together. We're serving together for the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what it is intended to be. Notice in verse 11, And he settled there a year and 6 months, doing what? Teaching the Word of God among them. He went there. He settled there for 18 months. And what did he do? He taught the Word of God among them. His burning desire was to share Jesus, and you do that best by teaching the Word of God. Follow the lives of Aquila and Priscilla, and you will see that they caught that same sense of urgency and that same sense of determination that we find in the Apostle Paul. May our burning desire be to share Jesus as we share His Word faithfully, as we endure the hardships unwaveringly, and as we refuse to be stopped before we fulfill the will of God in our individual and our corporate lives. Where does it all begin? You know where it begins? It begins with conversion. It begins with conversion. It begins by coming to that place in your life to where you realize that you are separated from God because of sin. When you realize that you have never surrendered your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Maybe you're a member of a church. Maybe you're a member of this church. None of that makes any difference whatsoever unless you have made a commitment to Jesus as your Lord and as your Savior. You've been born again. You've entered into the kingdom of God. Have you made that decision? It's pointless to try to make the outside appear a certain way when the inside hasn't been changed. Do you know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior? We talked about commitment. We talked about being so committed to the Lord and seeing what He's doing in your life. We talked about companions, about being a part of a church where the gospel is preached and doing our part, being a part of what's going on. We talked about conviction. Having that conviction that what God leads you to do, He is going to bear fruit in it. He's going to bear fruit. So whatever He's done in your life, whatever He's doing in your life, He has a purpose for you. Are you surrendered to that purpose? Are you surrendered, first of all, to Him? Then are you surrendered to His purpose? You're unique. Every one of you are unique. You're so unique that I don't understand you sometimes. You're unique from me. And I praise God for every one of you because He's doing a unique work in your life. And together as companions in the gospel, we can experience the blessings of God. I'm going to ask you to bow your head and just surrender your heart to Him right now. If our worship team will come, they're going to sing. This is a time of meditation. It's a time of listening to the Lord. Don't just listen to music. Listen to Him. Let this just be a time where you are blessed and encouraged and strengthened. And if there be a person here that doesn't know for sure that you've trusted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, it's a personal decision. If you understand that Jesus died on the cross to pay for your sins and you're willing to commit your life to Him, to surrender yourself to Him, to put all of your confidence in Him, you can be saved, but you need to make that decision. You need to surrender. If I can pray with you, if there's something that you need me to pray with you about, I'll be here at the front. But this is a time between you and God. You do what God would call you to do. You respond the way He's put it on your heart to respond.